What key this is?
Good morning, everyone. It is great to be in the house of the Lord this morning. What a great day it is to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I hope if you like cold weather, you're getting your feel. It is a frosty, chilly morning this morning when I got up at about 29 degrees and everything was white outside. And for those that like cold weather, it's here. But bless your heart. And for those of us that like it to be a little warmer, well, it'll get here later, a little bit later on. But I am so glad today to be in the house of the Lord.
Yes.
I am so glad that He has blessed us with the ability that we can be here. And blessed us with the desire that we want to be here to worship Him in spirit and in truth. I will tell you something. God is a great God. He's merciful. He's loving. He's compassionate. And He deserves our very best. And when we put forth the energy and we put forth the effort to worship Him, He is pleased and He is honored and He is glorified. Praise the Lord. We want to go to the Lord in prayer this morning as we begin our service today. We want to remember those on our prayer list. And there's so many today that are in need of a touch from the Lord, that they need His help and they need His touch in their bodies, in healing of their bodies and things. And so many have personal issues right now they're dealing with, that they need the Lord's help with as well. Anyone have a spoken or prayer request this morning? No? Yes. Let's take these needs to the Lord in prayer this morning as we begin our service together. Our Lord God of heaven, we love You and we thank You for this day of life. My Lord God of heaven, You have blessed us and You have kept us and You have brought us to this place today. And I'm asking You, Lord God of heaven, to be with us as we enter in to worship this morning. Lord of heaven, let everything we do bring You pleasure. Let everything we do lift You up and praise You, my Lord of heaven, because You are worthy of our praise. We're asking You, Lord, to remember these that we bring before You right now that have needs in their body, needs in their life. Lord God, You know the situation that You already have taken care of them, Lord, according to Your word. And we come to You this morning in faith, believing, trusting You and believing You for all things. Lord God of heaven, in Jesus' name, we worship You and we praise You. And amen. Let's worship this morning in song.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King,
standing on the promises of God, I say. Yes, amen. Thank the Lord for his promises this morning.
Yes, it does. Amen.
Then sing thy song. Don't let our praise
be empty space. Come abide in this place. Every heart you are transforming. Come through out of your glory.
Yes, amen.
Darkness trembles, mountains crumble. When you draw near to us,
yes.
You draw near.
Hallelujah.
To us. Strongholds breaking, destinies changing. When you draw near to us, you draw near to us. Don't let our praise be empty space. Oh, come abide,
come abide
in this place. Every heart you are transforming. Come through, have your glory. Darkness trembles, mountains crumble. When you draw near to us, you draw near to us. Strong.
Yes.
Oh,
Hallelujah. Praise your holy name, Lord. Yes, Lord. We worship you in this place today, Lord. As we sense your nearness, as we sense your presence. Lord God of heaven, draw us nearer. Draw us nearer this day to you. My loving Lord of heaven, let us feel your magnificence. Let us feel your splendor as it fills every fiber of our being and every crevice of this place. Lord of heaven, as we honor you, as we praise you, as we worship you, Lord, as we lift our hearts to you today, my Lord of heaven, we worship you because you are worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy. Of the Lord that I feel in this place this morning.
Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
The words of this song that she sang were so true. Draw us, Lord. Draw us. We want to run into your presence.
Yes.
I want to run. I'm excited. See, the singers didn't have any idea what I was going to be preaching on this morning. I never share with my wife ahead of time anything about what the Lord lays in my heart. She hears it the first time when you hear it. But it's confirmation of what the Lord laid on their hearts this week. As they began to pray and the Lord began to put the music together because he knew what he had laid on my heart. You'll see what I'm talking about as we get into the service this morning. But I want to let you know that I do love and appreciate the way the Holy Spirit works and puts things together in a way to build us up and bless us. And help us to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Yes, amen.
Thank you so much. I want to share with you this morning something that the Lord has laid on my heart for the hour that we're living today. I don't know whether you can sense it or not, but I sense a spirit of urgency that's in the air. I have a strong feeling. And when I say this, it's one of those things that you can't sit down and map out on a piece of paper and draw point A to point B to point C or even write it out or whatever. But I have a strong feeling in my heart and a feeling in my spirit that something is about to take place.
Yes.
Something is about to take place that's going to amaze and astound this generation in which we're living. Now hear me when I tell you, but I believe with all my heart that the Lord is doing a work among his people today. Yes. Among those who are willing to listen, and for those who are wanting to be involved, and for those who are willing to invest in kingdom ministry, I want to tell you something. The Lord is fixing to use these in a mighty way in this thing that's about to take place. Can I tell you, for those who are willing to invest in kingdom ministry, you are going to receive kingdom blessing and reward. Now hear what I'm saying. Unto whom much is given, much is required. But as we pour into the kingdom of God, and as we pour into the things that the Lord is doing in these last days, just before the rapture of the church, can I tell you that we're going to receive a return on investment this side of glory that's going to amaze and astound the world in which we live.
Yes.
And there's going to be people that are going to be upset. The Holy Spirit's already laid this on my heart, and he said, don't get upset. Tell people, don't get upset when they see the Lord blessing others and he's not blessing them in the same measure. Maybe they haven't invested in, you haven't invested in kingdom ministry the way they have. Because for those who are investing in kingdom ministry in these last days, you're going to see multiple return on investment in a heavenly realm. You're going to see the Lord, what it means firsthand, when the Word says he's going to open the windows of heaven and pour out blessings upon you that you cannot contain it.
Hallelujah.
We are in what I have often heard to and referred to as a suddenly season, where we're going to see the Lord do things suddenly, at a rapid pace, at a rapid rate. Jesus spoke of this in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, when he was talking about the days that being shortened. And he said that unless they be shortened, no flesh should be saved. But for the elect's sake, he would shorten the days. Amos talked about this in Amos chapter 9, verse 13, where he talked about how that the plowman would be overtake the reaper. We understand what he's a little bit about what he's talking about is because there is usually a time involved between the time the seed is planted until the seed is harvested. But there is a spirit and a time of acceleration right now to where they're going to go hand in hand. Just as soon as the seed is sowed, it's going to come up and begin to reap a bountiful harvest.
Yes.
Now, I want to tell you, why is this so important? Because I want to tell you, church, and I can't emphasize this strongly enough. There's an event that's about to take place that has been preached and talked about for over 2,000 years. Because one day, 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ left this earth, went away in a cloud, and angels said, why stand you gazing upward? This same Jesus is going to come back in like manner. Can I tell you, my friend, I believe with all of my heart, soon and very soon, we're going to see Jesus come back on the clouds of glory and take his church out of this place. But I will tell you, I believe with all of my heart that there are some things that the Lord wants to do. There are some things, some blessings that he's wanting to do. There's some ministry that he's wanting to do. There's some work that he wants to do before this takes place.
Yes.
We read in the book of Amos, chapter 9, and we see that there is an importance in this last day. Oh, I want to tell you, we see where he talked about raising up the tabernacle of David that had fallen. The tabernacle of David that has fallen, and close up the breaches thereof. And he said he was going to raise up the ruins. He's going to build it as in days of old. Can I tell you this morning, church, that the Holy Spirit is at work today doing a work of restoration, doing a work of restoring some things that have been falling down. Now, yeah, I can stand and pray and talk about that for a while. You know, why do things fall down? A lot of times they fall down because they've been neglected. So somewhere along the line, then you've got to go prop them back up. Somewhere along the line, you build a house and you've got to do maintenance on it. You build a house and you've got to take care of it. And you've got to make sure it's painted and all these things that go in. If you don't, it's very soon, very suddenly, it's going to begin to collapse and implode around you. My friend, I'm saying there's a lot of things that the Lord is going to restore and build up in this last day because they have fallen down. They've become neglected and forgotten. But He is going to stir the hearts, and He is stirring the hearts, and He is stirring the minds, and He is stirring the spirits of His people who are willing to hear and willing to be involved, and He's doing a restoration work in this last day.
Yes, He is.
Building blocks are being prepared as we speak that will aid in the things that will take place in the transition period from the time the church age ends and the kingdom age begins. What are you talking about? There's a period of time by time the church age ends. We're the church age. When does the church age end? When the rapture takes place. When does the kingdom age begin? That's when Jesus Christ comes back. Not to rapture the church, but He comes back for what we often refer to as the millennial reign. But there's some things that's going to take place during this time frame between when the church age ends and the kingdom age begins. And there are building blocks and being laid and put in place right
yes.
now to fulfill the events and things are going to happen there.
Yes, amen.
Can I tell you something? The Lord has empowered His church in this hour that we're living today. He has empowered His church to do their part in this restoration process that He's involved in. He's just like Pastor Brother Tim Hill, the general overseer of the Church of God, often says about the baptism in the Holy Spirit. He said it's for our employment, not for our enjoyment.
Yes.
He gives us the Holy Spirit. Yes, it's a pleasure. And yes, it will help us to be in our feeling. But it's not about our feeling. He gives us the power, and He's endued us with the power to be of service to Him
yes.
this last day.
Amen.
Now, He said that He wants to raise up the tabernacle of David. There are two things that the Lord has shown me in this scripture in Amos 9 and 11 that I want to share with you this morning. And I want to tell you, I'll pour my heart out to you as the Lord has poured it into me. Because it's very important that we hear the word of the Lord in this last day. The tabernacle of David, we don't hear a lot about it in Scripture. We know the tabernacle of Moses. That's the more familiar tabernacle that we read about in Scripture. And we know that there was a great deal of detail and there was a great deal of instruction given. Matter of fact, we spent how many weeks on Wednesday night doing a study on the tabernacle of Moses. Then there was a temple that Solomon would later build. And in that temple, once again, there was much information given as to the construction of the temple and the things that went there. It was one of the greatest things the world had ever seen, the temple that Solomon built for the glory of God.
Amen.
But nestled between the tabernacle of Moses and the tabernacle and the temple of Solomon, there is the tabernacle of David. What is the tabernacle of David? When David brought the Ark of the Covenant that had been captured and taken away and had been forgotten for some Bible scholars say for possibly up to 100 years since it had been first taken from the time where Eli was the priest and his sons Hophni and Phinehas were supposed to be taking care of the business practice of the temple, but they worked and how that they took the Ark of the Covenant out of tabernacle where it was supposed to be kept, and they took it to battle thinking that they could frighten their enemies with it. The Lord never gave them instruction. The Lord never told them to do that, and we know that they were defeated in battle and the Ark was taken.
Yes.
When the Ark was returned after a period of time, it came back and it sat idle, forgotten, forsaken. People had just kind of put it out of their mind. David, whenever he became king many years later, he began to stir his heart because he understood that the Ark of the Covenant was a representation of the glory of God.
Yes.
The Ark of the Covenant was a representation of the Spirit of God. It was a representation of the presence of God. And David was a man that now let me say this. David was not a perfect man. He was like you and I. He had his faults and he had his flaws. But David was a man who had a heart toward God.
Yes.
And he wanted to be near God. He wanted to be near the presence of God. He wanted to be near the glory of God.
Yes.
He wanted not only for himself. You hear what I'm saying? Not only for himself, but he wanted for his household. He wanted his household to be near the glory of God.
Yes.
He wanted his family to be near the presence of God. He wanted his nation as the king, as the leader of the nation. He wanted his nation to be near the presence and the glory of God. I would to God today that we had leaders leading our nation from the highest to the lowest that wanted to be near the presence of the Lord. Like the song of Noel was just singing, that they would want to run into the presence of God and bring the people of this nation into the presence of God with them as they came. When we know David's first attempt at bringing the Ark failed because he didn't do it in the proper way. But whenever he got it right, and he brought it out of the house of Obed-Edom, and he did it the way that it was supposed to have been done, he brought it into the city of Jerusalem, where he lived. And he had pitched the tent, a place for the glory of God to dwell. Now not only did he pitch the tent, the scripture doesn't just stop there. But scripture tells us, is if you read through this, how that David employed singers and musicians and priests. That he employed, he started the tabernacle of David is a tabernacle of worship and a tabernacle of praise. There would be instruments that would be playing. They had a full orchestra of that day. There would be the stringed instruments because there would be those that would play the harp and the dulcimers and the other strings of the instruments that they would play. And 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, these musicians, by rotation, they would take their place and they would play beautiful music, beautiful worship music unto the Lord.
Yes.
Then there was the singers. They had a full orchestra. They had the full choir. They had the sopranos and the altos and the tenors and the basses and all these. As they would get together and while the musicians were playing, they were singing. They were singing melodious, beautiful words of praise and adoration unto the Lord. And while the music was playing and the singers were singing, there would be those priests that would be declaring the word of God. They would be speaking the word of God. They would be declaring, thus saith the word of God. My friend, let me tell you something. You talking about an atmosphere that I would want to be in.
Yes.
There's a CD that Jackie and I have, and I think I've bought a few of them and give them out as gifts to some folks. Where evangelist Jimmy Swaggart has music playing, he has singers singing while he recites some of the songs. Now, I want to tell you something. We're addicted to this. Why? Because you can put that thing on in your CD player in your house and turn it on while you're doing your housework or doing what, and then it changes the whole dynamics of the atmosphere of your house.
Yes.
You can put it on when you're going down the highway in your car, and it changes the whole dynamics of the atmosphere of your car. Because I'm going to tell you something. There is something about the worship music. There's something about singing worship songs. And there's something about declaring the word of God that in one of these individually, they have their place and they have their power. But you combine these three, and there's a force that cannot be broken.
Yes.
Amen.
There's a force.
Yes.
That cannot be broken. I love Hobby Lobby. One of the things I like about Hobby Lobby, not that I like all the doodads. Jackie likes the doodads. I go listen to the music. Because there's something about walking through Hobby Lobby.
Yes.
And they don't always have the words to the music. But if you listen closely, you can recognize the music that they're playing. And it makes it a joy to be there.
Yes.
It makes it a joy. You want to be there. I mean, I just like walking through the store, being under the sound of praise.
Yes.
Being under the sound of worship. Being under the sound of somebody that's magnifying and glorifying the Lord.
Yes.
Because I'm going to tell you something. There's a power in worship.
Yes, there is.
There's a power in worship. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Can I tell you that there was praise going on unto the Lord?
Yes.
People can hear it.
Yes.
From miles around.
Yes.
As on top of Mount Zion, on one of the high peaks of Jerusalem, Mount Zion, the tabernacle was erected, and people could see the tabernacle from afar, and they could see the glory of God as the Ark of the Covenant sat there in all of its splendor, in all of its glory, and they could hear the sounds of worship taking place and going on. And my friend, let me tell you, you talking about the song says, well, that we wanted to run to the presence of the Lord. I want to tell you something. It has a drawing effect.
Yeah.
When we get into worship, where genuine, heartfelt worship is taking place, my friend, it has a drawing effect.
Yes, it does. Yes, hallelujah.
24 hours a day.
Yes.
Worship could be heard. That was one of the reasons why the Lord said he had chosen Zion and had desired this for a place of his habitation.
Hallelujah.
In other words, he wanted his presence there.
Yes.
He wanted his spirit there. Why? Because there was continual worship and praise going forth unto him.
Yes.
He said this would be his resting place forever. He would dwell there. And he had a desire. Why? Because of the praise. Now I want to tell you something. Worship changes the atmosphere.
Hallelujah.
Worship drives away the darkness.
Yes, it does.
Worship drives away the forces of evil.
Yes, it does.
And the spirits of evil.
Yes.
That try to come against humanity and mankind.
Amen.
Oh, I'm going to tell you something. Oh, great day.
Hallelujah.
You know what it must have been like to have the sound of worship going on continually. My Lord, you go to work and things not going quite right on the job. Everybody know what I'm talking about there. Walk outside for just a minute and all you can hear was praise unto the Lord. You can hear the beautiful, melodious music of the instruments as they did their part. You can hear the singers as they blended in perfect unity and perfect harmony and did their part. And you can hear the priest as they stood decreeing and declaring, thus saith the Lord of God. My friend, let me tell you, it recharged your battery. It gives your energy. It turned your day around. You may have been having a bad day when you walked out, but you walk outside and you listen to that for a few minutes and it will turn your day around.
Yes, amen.
What it must have been like to have one of those days where life was getting on your last nerve. Just walk outside. Just walk, raise the window. Do something to get your head go outside. Because there's worship taking place. There's praise taking place. Glory to God is taking place. And I want to tell you something, my friend. It'll change everything about our life.
Yes.
And our lifestyle.
Amen.
Oh, what it must have been like to lay your head on the pillow at night.
Yes.
And as you lay there drifting off to sleep, to hear the sounds of worship.
Yes.
To know that the Lord was there with you. What it must have been like to wake up in the morning and hear the sounds of worship taking place. And you wake up with an assurance and you wake up with a confidence that, hey, whatever life brings my way today, me and the Lord's got this under control. He's going to take care of it.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Forevermore. I want to tell you something. But there are spirits and there are forces that it is their goal to stop the sounds of worship.
Yes.
In his own house, David experienced this.
Yes.
In his own home, David knew firsthand what it was to come against these forces that try to stop the sounds of worship. David had a wife, the daughter of Saul. Michal was her name. And she had the heart of Saul. You read, when you read her name in Scripture, she is never referred to as the wife of David. She's always referred to as the daughter of Saul.
Yes.
Because she had that old foul spirit that Saul had. That old jealous, envious spirit that Saul had. That old hateful spirit and attitude that Saul had.
Yes.
And she despised David for his worship.
Yes.
Although she was his wife, she despised him for his worship.
Yes.
Whenever, let's back up a little bit. Whenever they were bringing the Ark of the Covenant from the house of Obed-Edom, and they were bringing it into Jerusalem to place it on top of Mount Zion, David took off his robes of kingship. He took off his robes of trying to be royalty and dignitary and some high-hearted, high-headed individual. And he put on a linen ephod. He put on the robe of the priest. And he began to dance before the Lord. He began to worship. And he began to praise. And he began to glorify and magnify the Lord. I want to tell you, and he began to dance in the spirit and his wife, who should, if she would have been the wife, she should have been right there by his side, dancing along with him, worshiping the God along with him. But she chose to be somewhere else.
Yes.
Looked out the window and saw her husband undignified.
Yes.
You're the king. You shouldn't be acting like that. You shouldn't take off your robes that of precedence and prestige and high honor to lower yourself to worship your God this way. But oh, I want to tell you, I love the heart of David. I love the heart of David. As he looked at her. And if you allow me to preach and paraphrase it just a little bit, he looked at her and he said, "Honey, you ain't seen nothing yet.
Yes.
You ain't seen nothing yet. I'm going to keep on worshiping. I'm going to keep on praising.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to keep on dancing. I'm going to keep on singing. I'm going to keep on keeping on. And I'm probably going to get a little more undignified than what it was a little bit ago."
Yes. Hallelujah.
Because it ain't about me as king. But it's about him as Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah.
That's what it's all about. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Oh, my friend, let me tell you something. There are forces at work that try. Oh, it's not necessary. There's no need in getting carried away. You know, every now and then, just to do, sing a song every now and then is okay. Play a song every now and then is okay. Do something every now and then is okay. But my friend, let me tell you something. God's not in any of this every now and then stuff. But I want to tell you something. When we have people, the tabernacle of praise that David represented, it represented a lifestyle of worship.
Yes.
24 hours a day being dedicated and consecrated and my mindset that my life is going to be a praise unto the Lord.
Yes.
My life is going to be worship unto the Lord. How I conduct myself is going to praise the Lord. The words of my mouth are going to praise the Lord. The actions of my hands are going to praise the Lord. The places my feet take me are going to praise the Lord. Everything about me is going to praise the Lord. I have determined that I'm going to glorify and I'm going to magnify and I'm going to exalt Him and I'm going to extol Him with an attitude of worship and a lifestyle of worship.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And I tell you, that's the work of restoration. The Holy Spirit is trying to instill in the hearts of people today is to restore and resurrect a lifestyle of worship.
Yes.
Not just a Sunday morning religion.
Yes.
Not just a once a week or once a month thing. But 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Men and women, because see, we are the temple of the Most High God.
Yes.
We are the temple of the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. And wherever we go and whatever we do, we are taking the temple and we're taking the presence of God with us wherever. When we go to work, sometimes people wonder, why in the world am I working at this job? Honey, you may be working that job because you may be right exactly where the Lord wants you, because He wants His presence there through you.
Yes.
He wants His Spirit there through you. He wants to operate through you. He wants to do a work through you to touch those around you that need to know Him.
Yes.
Why am I in this situation? Why am I where I'm at? Why do I have you? I'm going to tell you something, my friend. It's because when we take on the lifestyle of worship and we take the Spirit of the Lord upon us and we allow Him to use us, He can flow through us to touch this world.
Yes. Amen.
And that's the restoration work He's trying to do in this last day.
Yes.
He's trying to restore lifestyle of worship.
Yes. Glory.
See, the Lord inhabits, He dwells in the praises of His people.
Yes, He does.
When we worship Him and we praise Him, the Word tells us in the Psalm, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
The heavens praise the Lord. The glory of God manifested throughout nature. But I want to tell you something. The trees wave unto Him as the breeze blows through the leaves and the branches are blowing. They're waving praises unto the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Can I tell you? He inhabits, He lives in, He dwells in the praise of His people. Can I tell you, I love what under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Paul told the Corinthians that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty.
Yes.
Can I tell you something?
Hallelujah.
Oh, my friend, help me this morning, Holy Ghost. We've got His Spirit. We've got His presence in us as we worship Him.
Yes.
And as we praise Him. And as we lead Him up, He begins to fill us. His presence begins to fill us. And where His Spirit is, wherever we go, there's liberty.
Yes.
Can I tell you, you can bring help to the downcast.
Yes.
You can bring relief to the oppressed.
Yes.
You can bring relief to the depressed. You can bring release and relief to those who are bound by addictions and bound by the chains of darkness. Why? Because the Spirit of the Lord is in you.
Yes.
And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
Yes. Yes.
That's the church.
Yes.
That's why we're here. is to set at liberty them that are bound.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The psalmist said in Judah, God is known. His name is great in Israel. We know that Judah means praise. In other words, in praise, God is known. When we begin to praise Him, God is known. When we begin to worship Him, God is known. When we begin to lift Him up, God is known. I never will forget back several years ago, Jackie and I were, I forget what store we were at. We were at some store, and I think the next aisle over from us, there was a mama that had a little girl that she got in, and I think if I'm not with memory serving, she started singing, Jesus Loves Me. And she, I'm not talking about she wasn't singing, Jesus Loves Me. This little baby doll was singing, Jesus Loves Me, this I know. And her mama was a little embarrassed, and she was over trying to, honey, calm down. Well, it didn't help. This old preacher heard what she was doing, and I got over beside her, and I said, honey, sing it. Sing it loud and sing it proud. Yes, and I joined in and began to sing it with her. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. My friend, let me tell you, this world needs to hear the praise and adoration of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's a lot of junk, and there's a lot of noise that's going forth today. My friend, they're putting people in darkness. They're putting people in bondage. They're putting people in captivity. It's time where we, as the church of the living God, lift our hands, lift our hearts, lift our voices, and begin to praise and adore the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and see the stronghold broken.
Lord Jesus, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah.
We don't have anything to be ashamed of.
Yes, hallelujah.
If I could act a fool the way I did on some things that I did when I wasn't living for the Lord, I've done some foolish things, some silly things. Made a fool of myself more than once. If I can make a fool of myself or the devil, I know. I don't care whether people think I'm foolish or not. I'm going to praise Him.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I'm going to praise Him. I'm going to praise Him not only for heaven. It's not just praising for fire in church. But I want to tell you something. I want to praise Him because I have been delivered.
Yes.
Oh, my, 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 my. We ain't got to help me, Holy Ghost, this morning. I have been delivered. I've been delivered from drugs. I've been delivered from alcohol. I've been delivered from hate. I've been delivered from a lot of things that were in my heart, that were in my life, that had me on the road of darkness and misery. And my friend, let me tell you something. I want to give Him thanks, and I want to give Him praise, because He set me free from these things. And now I'm on my way to heaven, and the journey keeps getting sweeter every day.
Yes.
I don't have to have drugs to help me make it through the day. I don't have to have alcohol to help me make it through the day. I don't have to have this or that or the other. My friend, I've got Jesus.
Yes.
And I've got the soul I need when I've got Jesus. I get up in the morning and He's there with me. He's there with me throughout the day. He's there with me throughout the night.
Yes. Amen. Hallelujah.
We make Him known through our praise.
Yes.
Does that mean you've got to go around saying Jesus, 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 Jesus all the time? No, you don't have to. But I'm going to tell you something, there's a lot of ways to praise the Lord.
Yes.
With our actions,
yes,
we can praise the Lord.
Yes.
With our lifestyle, we praise the Lord. Worship, praise, and worship is a lifestyle.
Yes, it is.
It's a way of living.
Hallelujah.
It's not turned on and off like a light switch. It's something we do 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Yes.
Oh, I want to tell you something. Jesus said in John's Gospel that if I be lifted up,
yes,
Oh, I want to tell you something. Church, we need to be about the business today of lifting up Jesus.
Yes.
We need to be about the business today of lifting up Jesus. Tim, can I tell you what the Lord has done for me? Oh, my friend, let me tell you, you got a headache. Can I remember? Can I tell you how the Lord touched my headache? You got a backache. Can I tell you how the Lord has touched my back? Oh, you got depression and discouragement. That's okay. But can I tell you, I know somebody that's able to take and lift you up out of that bondage and that pit of discouragement and depression. And his name is Jesus.
Yes.
It's time where we begin to lift him up.
Yes.
And when we begin to lift him up, we begin to glorify him and magnify him. We set the example for others. See, it's not just a Sunday morning in the church house type of thing. It's not just what we come in here, we feel all the goosebump and feel all the goody and leave here and forget about what that. My friend, I'll tell you, it's like when we come in here, it's like pulling up to the gas station and putting the nozzle in the tank. We come here to get filled up, to get recharged, to get re-energized, to get our tank filled back up so that we can go out into the highways and the byways and we can pour out.
Yes.
On this world around yes. us.
Amen.
Through a lifestyle of praise and worship. Magnify the Lord with me. What does it mean to magnify? To bring into clear focus.
Yes.
I want to tell you something. There's a lot of folks that have the wrong perception of who Jesus is. And it's up to us to bring him into clear focus.
Yes.
Magnify him. Put him under the microscope. Put him under the magnifying glass for the world to see. To see that he is the Savior of love. He is the Savior of grace. He's the Savior of mercy. He's the Savior of kindness. He's a friend that's sticking closer than a brother. He is the Lord your shepherd that you'll not ever want. He's Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My friend, let me tell you this morning. Oh, I want to tell you. He said, not only is he wanting to bring back and do a restoration of praise and worship continually. He's wanting to close up the breaches.
Yes.
What are the breaches?
Yes.
You began to look at the definition of breach. And one definition of breach is a gap in a wall or a barrier. You look at another definition of it. And it says the act of breaking or failing to observe a law, agreement, or a code of conduct. Can I tell you there has been a breach in the gap for a long time.
Yes.
That he's wanting to use the church today to do a work of restoration.
Yes.
To rebuild the breach.
Yes.
What are you talking about? I'm talking about holy living.
Yes.
He's resurrected. He is resurrection. Restoring. Drawing. Working. To close the breach and bring holy living back into our culture.
Yes.
Again.
Yes.
I've always been known as a preacher of holiness. Not legalism. I don't like legalism, but I do believe that without holiness, no man's going to see the Lord. You talk about holiness, what is holiness? Christ-likeness. You want to know what it is to be holy? You get in the Word, you open it up and you start with Matthew, you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Start right there and really concentrate on the words that are in red and you can understand what holy living is all about. Holy living is Christ-like living. Living like Christ, thinking like Christ, talking like Christ, being like Christ, I have never in the years of ministry that I have been stood behind a pulpit and a podium as an evangelist and as a pastor, I have never felt the unction of the Holy Spirit stronger than I have these last few years, than this last couple of years, is to teach and encourage and remind the church that we are the examples that the world should be following.
Yes.
We are the role models for this world. The world should be patterning themselves after us rather than we trying to pattern ourselves after the world.
Amen.
We're the salt.
Yes.
We're the light.
Yes.
We are the one to make a difference. He's doing a work in these last days to restore.
Yes.
And raise up the ruins. I don't have time this morning to go into how they got there, but that's beside the point. But the important thing is, he's wanting to raise them back up. And he's looking for a people. He's looking for a people who are willing to say, Lord, here I am. Use me.
Yes.
Lord, here I am. I'll take the challenge. I'll put on the responsibility. I'll take on because it means the difference between men and women going to heaven or hell. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. If the church doesn't step up to the plate and be the church, there are millions that are headed to hell on a slippery slope.
Yes.
And just before the rapture of the church, the Lord is doing a stirring. He's doing a working. He's trying to do a restoration for those that will allow him to use these men. It's not his will that any should perish. Any. No one. It's not his will that any should perish. But that all, A-L-L, should come to repentance.
Yes.
How does that work? It works through the Holy Spirit working through the church. Us. The embodiment of Christ, the church.
Amen.
To be in that vessel that he can use in these last days to flow through us to make a difference in this world. We're in a construction zone this morning. Let me ask you. You ready to put your hard hat on and get to work? We're in a construction zone this morning where there's a lot of hard work to be done.
Yes.
And I'm not going to soft soap it. I'm not going to try to whitewash it and tell you that construction work is not easy. Construction work can be very taxing to the body. We're in a construction zone this morning. He's doing a restoration and a remodel to try to change the ways and things that are done before the rapture of the church.
Yes.
So that men and women have an opportunity to see Jesus Christ in the right light and be saved all this time.
Yes.
Are you willing to be a part of the construction crew? Are you willing to say, Lord, here I am. Use me. Bow your head with me this morning. No one's looking. I'm not going to ask for any show of hands or anything else. But I do want you in your heart right now to think about it. There's some things that the Lord is trying to bring back. Some changes he's trying to bring to the church. Not only to the building, but to the people, to the body. Some changes and some restoration that needs to take place. That's going to change the face of this earth. I recently got through reading the book that dealt with what many Bible scholars believe is taking place right now is a final wave of the Holy Ghost moving across and around the world to try to do the work that needs to be done to see people saved right before the rapture. I ask you this morning, do you know somebody that needs Jesus? Is there somebody in your family that needs Jesus? Is there somebody on your job that needs Jesus? Is there a neighbor or a friend that needs Jesus? The Lord wants to use you in this last day to be that vessel. Now let me say this. You may not be the one to touch them, but maybe you can say something to somebody else, and that somebody else may be the one to reach you. But He wants a willing vessel. My wife's playing the music to the little chorus we sang, "Draw Me, Lord." That's exactly what He's doing right now. He's drawing us. His Spirit is drawing us. His Spirit is saying, come get on board. Come join my construction, my restoration. Are you willing to get on board this morning? If you're willing to get on board this morning, every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. If you're not doing this for man, you're doing this for the Lord. But if you're willing to get on board this morning, just raise your hand up real quick, bend it back down. Lord, here I am, use me. Lord, here I am, use me. I want to be a vessel that you can use. I want to be someone that you can use. Use me, Lord. He sees the heart. I tell you this morning,
and I'll run after you.
Don't walk after him, run after him. Run to where he's at. Run to him. Run to his presence. Run to his nearness. Run to his word. Run to his Spirit.
Yes, Lord.
this morning. I sense His presence here this morning. And I feel a word in my heart. Is He speaking to someone today? You push back and you've resisted. You push back and resisted long enough. It's time to come back to the Father's house. And be that chosen vessel that I'm obeying to today. His Spirit is drawing this morning. His Spirit is drawing. The choice is yours. Today and all week. But remember Wednesday night, we weren't able to have service Wednesday night because we had so many that were out sick. So we'll start our new Bible study this Wednesday night. And if you can be here, try to be here. I think you'll enjoy it. Between now and then, read Genesis chapter 3 and be studying it, getting it in your mind and in your spirit. And we will begin our study. Thanksgiving is approaching. Looking forward to a time of Thanksgiving. We'll probably do something special next week for our Thanksgiving service. So be here for that. Bring somebody with you when you come to the house of the Lord. Let's stand to this.
Brother Danny, would you dismiss us, please?
Precious Lord in heaven, Lord, we're here for you this morning. And we thank the Holy Spirit for surrounding us this morning and being with each and every